For all the knowledge of the thousands of scientists and engineers in the space industry, sometimes the old adage of the best laid plans of mice and men can be equally applied to their efforts. This was certainly the case of the Mars Climate Orbiter mission of 1999, and this would go down in space history as one of the biggest facepalms to date. If you're an avid comment reader, then you may have seen comments on my videos about why I tend to use both imperial and metric units instead of just metric. Basically, the simple answer is that many people in the US and the UK still use the imperial system, even though metric is now the de facto measuring system in the science and engineering worlds. Now, this is fine providing that you don't get them mixed up when you're doing your calculations, like the engineers and navigators of Lockheed Martin and NASA did in 1999. In the late 1990s, NASA was under pressure by the Clinton administration to make each mission go faster, smaller, and cheaper. So rather than focusing on a single large project, NASA diversified their operations. This meant that in 1999, whilst servicing the Hubble Space Telescope and building the International Space Station, NASA also planned a low-cost program to operate three missions simultaneously on the Red Planet. The Mars Surveyor 98 program featured the Mars Polar Lander with a pair of impactor microprobes on board and a satellite and communications relay, which was the Mars Climate Orbiter. This extraterrestrial probe, it was hoped, would conduct the first long-term detailed study of Martian weather. Mars Climate Orbiter had to be low mass, so it was fitted with a single solar panel rated at 500 watts at Mars. This asymmetrical design meant that the spacecraft was subjected to rotational force as the panel caught the solar wind. The probe could correct for this using the onboard reaction wheels, but these needed to be periodically desaturated or reset using corrective burns from its hydrazine thrusters. These routine manoeuvres were recorded in a file on Lockheed Martin's ground-based computer, from which the navigators had calculated periodic course corrections. However, during the 9-month trip, regular tiny thruster burns were compounding into a sizable problem. As was customary, Lockheed Martin's contract stipulated that all communications should use the standard metric units. So, in daily sensor readings, all data was assumed to be the metric standard of newtons of force per second. Unfortunately, there had been a major oversight. The files actually contained measurements in pounds of force per second, using the imperial units, which were still widely used in the launch industry at the time. Because 1 pound force equals 4.45 newtons force, each of the corrective thruster operations was underestimated by a factor of 4.45, putting the craft into the wrong trajectory. These showed up when several navigators at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, or JPL, noticed that something was amiss. The probe was making more than 10 times as many minor adjustments as planned as it tried to compensate to keep it on course. However, these concerns were never raised formally. On September 23, 1999, the Mars Climate Orbiter was scheduled to approach the Martian surface at a distance of 140 miles, 226 kilometers, whilst performing a long retrograde burn to enter an elliptical orbit around the Red Planet. Just one day before arrival, JPL's latest calculations indicated that the probe might be off course and could approach Mars at an altitude of just 93 miles or 150 kilometers. The operations team met and discussed the possibility of executing a contingency burn to raise the trajectory of the probe. But with only a day to upload and carry out this maneuver and some uncertainty about the precise location of the probe, the burn was never executed. Now the team could only hope that the approach would not be further off course than calculated. If the probe's altitude dipped below 53 miles or 80 kilometers, it would burn up in the atmosphere. Far from Earth, Mars Climate Orbiter continued its course and at 9 a.m. UTC began its main engine burn. The probe decelerated and passed beyond the horizon of Mars out of radio contact. 23 minutes later, the ground control team listened for a signal but heard only silence. The Mars Climate Orbiter was never heard from or seen again, and no wreckage has been found to date. but more detailed calculations later indicated that its course fell to just 37 miles or 60 kilometers from the surface. At this altitude, there was no way back. The atmospheric friction was far beyond the fragile probe's limits, and the orbiter was destroyed. After the incident, a report was commissioned, which is still available to download and read, which criticized the lack of communications within NASA and with the contractor Lockheed Martin, and the lack of training for key operatives on the mission. Lockheed Martin and JPL learned from their mistakes. 5 years later, the two organizations together developed the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, a mission that accomplished many of the goals of its ill-fated predecessor, using exclusively the international language of scientific measurement, namely the metric system. Now, technically, the probe was not lost because of maths, but because the calculations were fed the wrong information, namely good old-fashioned human error. It's the old programmer saying of rubbish in, rubbish out. But when all the data is correct, it's amazing what can be done with just the power of math. Our modern world and things like space probes to Mars would just not be possible without someone doing the calculations. If you've ever wondered what it takes to calculate the route for a Martian probe, well, the guys over at Brilliant.org can help you. Brilliant is an interactive problem-solving website where you get to learn by solving real-world problems and think like a scientist or astronomist. There are tons of problem-solving courses on things like gravitational physics that underpin the motion of the planets, or you can try your hand at astronomy and do things like finding out the size of the universe. And if you're into rockets and stuff, you can try classical mechanics to work out how things move around on Earth and in space. Sounds like rocket science? Well, it is, but that doesn't mean to say it has to be hard. Brilliant do this by showing you problems and breaking them down into easy to understand steps, then putting them back together so you can see how the overall process works. They also have a large, active worldwide community ready and willing to help you along every step of the way, so you're never alone. To help support us at Curious Droid and to learn more about Brilliant, just click on the link to brilliant.org/Curious Droid and sign up for free. As a special bonus for Curious Droid viewers, the first 200 people to sign up will get a 20% discount off of their annual subscription.